delight to have you here.
It's nice to be here after all this.
It's been
time.
A long time, yeah.
11 years.
We met about 11 years ago. Yeah.
When you were on the other side of the camera.
Yeah, that's true. Well, we met, let's get this out there, because this people you're on, people are going to want to talk about this more than anything else. You were in the film Hot Rod.
Hot Rod.
Starring Andy Samberg.
Which has become one of those cult movies.
Yeah. You played Andy Samberg's father in the
Frank.
Film. Frank. You played Frank, the father.
Frank with a bad heart.
Yeah.
Andy is a stuntman who is determined to raise the money to buy me a new heart because I can't die before he beats the out of me because I don't think he's a man.
Yeah.
Until he can beat the
That was the basic thrust of his character.
I was a band
he had to save your heart so he could then beat the out of you.
That's right. With this known kung fu deal, which is a very funny fight, actually.
And you, it's probably the most dramatic work you've ever done. We actually have a clip. Let's take a look real quick.
I'm going to knock that ridiculous mustache right off your face.
All great men have mustaches, Frank.
Yeah, but real men actually grow them, huh?
You know I have a hormone disorder!
Bravo. And do you... Is it true? Is it true that people approach you and ask about Hot Rod?
Well, the nice thing is about when people approach you and they do that thing, they go... And you're expecting them to say maybe, you know, Deadwood, Lovejoy, and they go... Hot Rod. And you go, it's great, because it's unexpected, and I didn't see it from when it first came out, and caught up with on cable, and it's a really funny
movie. It's a really funny movie, and I'm going to tell you this. Almost everybody who saw it caught it on cable.
Yeah, they were very cruel to that, to Andy, when he came out.
Yeah,
but they occasionally do that. They pick some comedy and decide to sort of, you know, go to town on it.
Yeah, but it has become the cult classic that it deserves to be. So this show, speaking of cult classics, so this book is a beloved book, American Gods, and Neil Gaiman, the writer, is sort of a beloved creator. Did that make it... What is it like when you approach material like that?
Well, I've worked with Neil before. I did Coraline. He's one of those authors that is great to have because he loves talking about what he does.
Yeah.
And Brian Fuller's another one, the very creative producer of the show, along with Michael Green, who I'd worked with before on a show called Kings. And the book came out, and it's one of the... We went to Comic-Con last year, and Gaiman was like, you don't realize, like, wow. The reception is like, he's, you know, rock star in that world of futuristic. And he loves commingling, talking about his work, which takes the pressure off, because they can deal with social media. Then you can just get on with the acting. So when it came to it, I mean, he's very much... He wrote a blueprint for a great, bold television series. And so far, that's people have received it that way. It's out there, it's bold, it's bright. A lot of shows say, you know, oh, we're pushing the envelope. It's a different TV show. This actually is, I think.
It really is.
But I didn't see it. I was telling you before, your research, that I hadn't seen it, because I don't go to rushes and see all that, you know, not producing it. So I saw it for the first time down at the Austin South by Southwest Festival, where they showed it on a big screen. And I was absolutely like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, that's why you join. You know?
And you can tell in the first 15 minutes it is not, it is very unlikely.
Oh, you could always tell. Well, you know in the first few, I usually know in the first few minutes of everything. When you watch it, if you're in good hands, even if it's not your kind of material. You know when you're in the good hands of somebody who's creative and it's got something to tell, it's got a real story, and it's got all, this has got animation, it's got prologues, it's got...
And you were playing, for those who don't know, you were playing, because basically it just looks like two guys in an airplane, but you were playing an old god. Explain the premise of this show a little.
Well, it's all about Shadow Moon, played by Ricky Whittle, who's great, actually, Ricky.
Your co-star in that scene?
Yeah. Yeah, and the girls love him, and he's... But he's got the most difficult part. He's because everything is seen through his eyes. He's a convict. He's come out of prison 2 days early because he's heard his wife's died, and he's on his way to the funeral, and suddenly he comes across in the airplane, the scene you saw, this character, Mr. Wednesday. Well, he says, what's today? And he says, Wednesday. He says, well, that'll do. Today's my day. And if you know your Norse mythology, you'll know Wednesday's Wotan. Wednesday, Wotan, Odin. The old Norse god.
They all knew. They're
they all knew that. They're all in the Norse mythology.
It's a real Norse room tonight. You can always tell.
But it's, you know, and it's, and that's who he is. I mean, but he's, and they realize it, he hires Shadow as his bodyguard driver. And they go on this sort of road trip buddy movie for a while, actually, for about, you know, until he meets all these extraordinary characters, realize that, what is this? And nothing is as it seems ever in this show. There's a reveal upon a reveal. And he realized eventually Mr. Wednesday's is rounding up all these old gods who came to America years ago. Like we all are, immigrants to this country, this terrific country. Immigrants and gods, and when immigrants came, they brought their gods with them. They didn't bring their demons because they were too scared to cross the ocean.
Sure, right.
But the gods came.